You remember that olfactory memory we all have from our middle school days when we were too cool for school so we'd roam the malls on Saturdays with our friends? Always to be lured in by the soft pretzel storefront, distinguishable by its particular aroma that seemed to fill the entire mall. Only to wait in line for too long to buy pretzels covered in grease and salt that cost far too much. Yeah, me too. Here's the thing. Malls are dying, and the need for delicious soft pretzels is still very much present. I'm gonna fix this issue. In college, I learned how to make soft pretzels, and today I'm gonna teach you. I wanna give a big shout out to all the food package designers out there who are designing food packages that are actually easy to open and maintain their structural integrity, because let me tell you, that is not always the case. If you're part of the latter half of the food packaging design community, shame on you. Let me show you what I mean. I have two examples here. Here's this beef stick. They only give you one option to open. Tear here. Okay, sure. But then it gets all torn up and it doesn't open properly and it's all stuck together and then you're stuck trying to get it open. Too much effort. And then, like, what if I don't eat the whole beef stick? Then I can't put it back in the bag. It's already torn apart. I have to eat this whole thing in one serving. I mean, this is a mini one, but normally they're like this long. Now, here we have a chip bag. More than one serving size in the bag. So it should be openable and closable, because how am I supposed to eat the whole serving when doing what the FDA recommends? They've done it right. They're able to just pull it apart at the top, very clearly, maintaining the structural integrity, and then when I'm done, I pull it back over, clip it, and save it for later. Or maybe I'm gonna share it with a friend, who knows? Some of them, they have it where you rip down the side, then how are you supposed to ever close the bag again? I'm forced to eat all the chips. I just want my food packages to be opened easily and the ability to reclose when applicable. Food package designers, please dig deeper. Find better adhesives and better designs that allow this to happen. Also maintaining freshness, because that's important too. There's a growing problem in this country with food packages not having the user's experience in mind. It needs to end now. Anyways, back to the food at hand. Homemade pretzels. Because I've been making them for quite a while, I was able to identify five elements that you need to consider when making homemade soft pretzels. Let's go. Okay, the first element to consider is the equipment you'll need. It's actually not too extensive, because this is a very simple recipe. You'll need a liquid measuring cup set and a dry measuring cup set, 2 to 3 large bowls. You can do it in two, but I like to use three because then you don't have to clean them in between. A wooden spoon. You don't want to use plastic because it might not be strong enough. A baking sheet, parchment paper preferred. A good work surface, like a countertop. In college, I actually didn't have a countertop, so I used a large cutting board kind of set on top of my sink, and it worked like a charm. You'll also need a pastry brush and a small bowl of vegetable oil, and also, you will need some patience, because this is a long process. Element two is ingredients. You'll of course need flour. I use bread flour because it ends up with a bit of a better consistency for pretzels, a little bit crunchier than regular all-purpose flour. But you can use all-purpose flour if that's all you have on hand. You'll need one bowl with 1.5 cups of flour and the other bowl with 1.25 cups of flour, separated. You'll need some salt. I always use coarse kosher salt by Morton Salt because it seems to work really well for this recipe and gives just the right amount of flakiness and flavor. You'll also need a packet of yeast and a spoonful of sugar. And lastly, you'll need 1 to 2 tablespoons of baking soda. So now we move into element three, making the dough. First, you'll start off with 1 cup of water, 100 degrees Fahrenheit, in your liquid measuring container. Sometimes, if I'm feeling fancy, I'll use my laser thermometer to get the exact temperature, but if I'm feeling lazy, I just run my hand under the hot water. You're looking for about warm bath temperature. It's important that you don't have your water too hot, because that will kill the yeast, and if it's too cold, you'll not end up with a good fermentation process. So you really want to be right in the middle there. Once you have your water, you're going to want to stir in a spoonful of sugar.
Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down.
Until it's all dissolved. This will not help the medicine go down in this case, but it will help the yeast rise faster and more efficiently. Now sprinkle in your yeast packet and stir it. Put that aside for 10 minutes. It should form a thick, frothy foam on the top. If you don't have a frothy layer after 10 minutes, either your yeast didn't have anything to eat, or the water was too hot and it died, or your yeast was just too old. Start out with a fresh packet. So I mentioned you need to keep the two separate flour bowls. It seems silly, but it actually does make the recipe better. You're gonna wanna mix a pinch of salt into the 1.5 cups of flour. It's important that you mix the salt into the flour, because if you don't, it could kill the yeast and then you wouldn't have a good rise for your pretzels at all. You're gonna wanna add 2 tablespoons of oil to your yeast mixture and stir. Now you'll pour those liquids into the 1.5 cup bowl of flour. You'll mix that with a wooden spoon until you have a homogeneous mixture that is smooth. It should look like this. Then you'll begin mixing in the 1.25 cups of flour in a few additions until you get the right consistency. It's gonna look pretty rough at first, but after kneading it for 5 minutes or so, you should have a very smooth ball of dough about this big. You can do the kneading with a stand mixer with a dough hook, and I've done this in the past, but I actually feel that kneading it by hand gets a better consistency and a better even rise. Once you have your ball formed, you're going to place it into the third bowl, which you're going to want to pre-grease. And then you want to cover the top with a dish towel, or I usually use saran wrap so I can make a better seal. Put that in a warm place to rise for 1 hour. I usually put mine in the microwave. When you return, your dough ball should have doubled in size, and the bowl should be warm. Not because of the hot water, but because fermentation is an exothermic reaction, meaning it produces its own heat. Fun little science tip for you. Okay, now we can move into element 4, actually making the pretzels. But just so you know, this dough that we've just made, if you didn't use bread flour, would be a typical dough that you could use for many things, like pizza dough and bagels, and you could even do a cinnamon roll out of it. So what distinguishes a pretzel from all of those other things is the baking soda bath. So don't skip out on this step. You'll want to add 1 to 2 tablespoons of baking soda to about 4 to 6 cups of water in a saucepan and bring to a boil. While that's boiling, you can begin shaping your pretzels. First, I divide the dough ball into 12 equal pieces by cutting it with a knife. Sometimes I do 24 pieces if I really want tiny mini pretzels. Just be sure to keep your dough covered when you're not working with it. I take it off in chunks so that a skin doesn't form on the outside of the dough. Something to keep in mind as you're rolling out your pretzels is that the diameter of your rope will affect the taste and consistency of your pretzel. If you have a very thin rope, you'll have more surface area to dough ratio, meaning more contact with the baking soda bath, which will make a crispier, crunchier pretzel. If you want a fluffier, more bready pretzel, you can make the rope thicker. I like to fall somewhere in the middle, not too thin, not too thick, so I have that nice crisp exterior with a nice soft interior. It's best to make all the pretzels in one batch the same thickness so that you don't have to worry about varying baking times. In order to make the classic pretzel shape, you'll make a U out of your pretzel, then cross the top, twist it over once, and fold it over, pinch at the edges, transfer to the pre-parchment papered baking sheet. After you're done with all of your pretzels, let them sit and rise for 20 to 30 minutes. This usually works out pretty well because it takes me about 20 minutes to get through all of the pretzels, and that's right about when the baking soda bath has started to boil, so I can just begin from there. What you want to do to get them in the baking soda bath is carefully pick them up, plop it face down in the baking soda bath, wait 30 seconds, use a spatula to flip it in the water, wait another 30 seconds, and then carefully transfer it from the pot of boiling baking soda bath water back onto the baking sheet, then do a brush of oil and a sprinkling of salt so that it sticks. Once the entire batch has gone through the bath and received its oil and sea salt dressings, it's time to go into the oven. You should have preheated it to 475 degrees Fahrenheit, and you're going to be baking them for 12 minutes. Keep an eye on them because every oven is different. When they're golden brown on the top, pop them out and transfer them to a cooling rack. And then you're done. Enjoy your pretzels! Now, element 5 isn't technically part of the pretzel making process, but I wanted to include it because it's pretty cool. Just some science adjacents that let me nerd out completely. Starting with the yeast, I mentioned that I add a spoonful of sugar to the yeast. This is so the yeast has something to eat. If you add a lot of sugar, you'll end up with bigger air pockets, and if you add no sugar at all, you'll end up with a very flat pretzel. That's why I add about 1 tablespoon, a little bit less, so that I have a medium pocket size inside my pretzel. It's the consistency I prefer. The next science adjacent I have is ovens. Cooking times can vary based on the different types of ovens. I've used an electric oven and those are very accurate. So you want to get right on the 475 degrees and you're going to see it be exactly 12 minutes most of the time. I've also used gas ovens though, and those tend to run pretty hot from what I've found. So I usually go a little bit lower on the temperature there, and I have to keep a better eye on it to make sure that they don't burn. It's not as even of a baking as well, probably because it's harder to control the gas temperature inside the oven. And if you use a convection oven, that's something completely different, and I don't even know where to begin. But just experiment. You might not get it right on the first try. Another fun science adjacent is that the seasons will affect the recipe. It's such a simple recipe that everything needs to be fine-tuned and there's not a lot of room for error. So in my region, the summertime is very humid, meaning that even if you have your flour stored in a perfectly sealed container, you're still gonna need to add more flour because there's so much humidity in every element of the recipe. In the summertime, the pretzels never come out as crunchy as they do in the fall or winter. Ah, another interesting thing, the water itself will affect the pretzels. Because the fermentation process is so chemically driven, any different minerals in the water that you have in your region will yield a different pretzel. I've made pretzels all across the country, and there are little differences to the taste of each one, even when I use the same recipe.